Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. I have a book that will take you from a billion years ago to 9 years ago. But in that time, you're going to find out a lot about archaeology and what makes the world turn. The book is called The Null Quotient. It's by my guest, Philip F. Margot, and it's published by Eloquent Books. Welcome, Philip.
Pleasure to be here. Really.
Thank you.
A pleasure.
A billion years ago is when our friend Aniva, I'm not pronouncing her name.
Aniva.
Right. Aniva.
Yes.
Which I later discovered is I am here.
Yes. Well, that's what, that's what it means. It means essentially I am.
Yeah.
She is the pilot through whose eyes we see the destruction of the 28th configuration of civilization on this rock. In other words, you know, the book is based on the concept that this rock we live on, this earth that we call it now,
yeah,
is really 40 billion years old, and the universe is much older than we think it is. And on this rock, there have been 28 previous configurations of intelligent life that rose from the slime and destroyed themselves or were destroyed by an outside source like an asteroid strike or a megavolcano. And we're the 29th, teetering on the brink again, as usual. Yeah. And we see the end of a world through Aniva's eyes. She's a military pilot in her civilization. Mm-hmm. And we see her last day and her civilization's last day.
Well, then we go what was 9 years ago in the book with a girl named Leslie Rose Milstein was the family's real name.
Miles, right.
And she is sort of chunky and what have, and they send her off to a dig in the Negev.
In the Negev, yes.
In Israel. And she meets Dr. Isaac Carver.
Right.
Well, he's a rough, tough guy, and he has no use for spoiled Jewish girls.
Well, he actually has no use for anybody or anything.
Yeah.
He's kind of an SOB from the word go. He was a child prodigy. He got doctorates in archaeology and anthropology at the same time from Harvard, and he was 22 years old. But he couldn't work and play well with others.
Yeah.
And he made a mess out of every gig he had. But the point we meet him, he's 26 years old when he meets Leslie. He's 26 and she's about to start her fifth year at USC.
Yeah.
Because she wasn't much of a student or didn't have much of an ambition.
But from this summer, she loses 35 pounds because it's a little hot and very busy digging. And she also gets an A and goes back to college and becomes a lawyer.
Yeah, the summer turns her around. The summer with Isaac Carver, who treats everybody with disrespect, somehow, he couldn't explain it himself, helped this girl.
Yeah.
When he saw her dedication to her work, she found the work hard, but she found it as a cover for all the mess up stuff in her life, her lack of relationship with her parents, her obesity, her lack of self-esteem.
And 9 years later,
yes,
Carver is still drinking and becoming more of a bum. She's a brilliant lawyer.
Yes.
And he has found something up in Alaska.
Yes. Well, yes.
That he realizes something's there that nobody knows about.
Right.
But the place where he's digging is owned by, well, think of BP, think of Halliburton, and they control what he is going to be digging, and they don't want any part of it, and they can get the President of the United States to get him fired.
Fancy that.
Yeah.
Yes, well, you know how much of effect industry has on what happens in politics. You don't have to be a whiz to see it's happening here now. This story takes place 10 years in the future, but I don't see much of a change. And yes, he had a deal with the original owner of all this land, who was a gentleman who cared about the land, who honored the land. But the son, growing up to be a spoiled brat, decided he wants the oil that's sitting under that land, and he wants this guy off of the land. And he says, you're done. Yep. In the meantime, the word of the discovery of this craft that looks like it was built for flight and dates back over a billion years in a place where it should never have been found, when that happens, the people in the high part of the government say, wait a minute, there's something here. We can reverse engineer and come up with all kinds of amazing weaponry for a change, or maybe other things that the private sector could make a lot of money on.
And Isaac and Rosie, as he calls her, go into this cave, and there is this thing embedded in the glacier.
Right.
And as they find pieces of, they don't know what it is. It melts, light shine. Well, Everything happens and melts, and they discover there's a body in there.
Right. The Corey Glacier melts away, and inside, and the craft opens when Leslie touches it, and inside is a body that looks like, you know, in a flight suit that they thought would be just a bag of bones, but it isn't.
No,
it's far from.
And it is our friend Avani.
Aniva.
And they start to do an autopsy on her, and I love it. The hand rises.
Yeah, well, when the doctor, when they're doing the autopsy, when the business people, the corporations get a hold of the whole dig and throw him out, they bring the body to a secret base in the desert, and they're going to autopsy it. Well, they try to do it with MRIs and stuff, but all of the equipment fails. Finally, the doctor says, we'll just have to cut her open. And he's about to start cutting her open when her hand comes up and turns his away from the knife, away from her face, and makes him drop it, right? And that's all. And then goes back to no heartbeat, no nothing. There's nothing registered. They can't find her. Yeah, that tells Leslie and Isaac, especially Leslie. Yeah. Leslie says she served at the DA's office in L.A. for a summer, and she saw 19 dead bodies, and she knows what a dead body looks like, and this is not a dead body, you know, essentially.
Meanwhile, there's another interesting character, Dax.
Dax Wolf.
Yeah.
Dax Wolf is the child of an artificial insemination, you know, a woman who was a magnificently brilliant scientist, very successful, patents, books published, never wanted to get married, found a donor, had this child that almost died at childbirth, but survived, and didn't talk until he was 2 years old, and then he started talking in full sentences, and brilliant. Just
genius.
A brilliant, beyond genius. And he becomes the quote-unquote villain of the piece, the kind of super villain. Dax Wolf becomes a super villain of the piece. And eventually, he and Aniva have to duke it out, towards the end of the story.
Who are the nine sort of like, the nine philosophers, the nine controls?
Okay, the custodians. The custodians travel on light. They break themselves down into spectrons, I call them, the smallest fragment of light, smaller than photons. Spectrons make up photons, you know. And they travel across the universe looking for intelligent life. And their purpose is when a civilization destroys itself, instead of leaving the mess, the custodians use the null quotient to null everything back to stardust so life can begin again from the slime. Not an offshoot of the civilization that already screwed up, but a brand new kind of life.
Sort of based on, I would say, history repeats itself.
Yes, and even though it does, they keep changing the dice for a different outcome.
How did Philip Margot decide the research you had to do to come up even with these words? This was not your field.
Well, it wasn't, well, nothing, writing was not my field either. I mean, I didn't even start writing for the screen until I was in my 40s, and that was out of self-defense because I couldn't get anything made. I had these ideas, you know, but I couldn't, when they assigned a writer to it, it went away, you know, it failed in development. Finally, I said to ABC, look, let me develop it myself. Let me give you something. If you don't like it, at least I'll die by my own hand.
Yeah.
And the thing that I developed got made eventually. So I figured, okay, I would do that. And I got a whole bunch of stuff made. So now, you know, I mean, two or three years ago, I don't have the connections in the television business anymore that I have had. And what happens when you come up with an idea? You know, I mean, it's very hard for a creative person to come up with an idea and not act on it.
Yeah.
So when you start acting on it, I said, I'm going to write a screenplay. I said, why should I write a screenplay? There's no one for me to show it to. I said, let me try to write a book.
But the research, I'm fascinated by the science. I assume it's based on fact, the scientific sort of, investigation that you did on, as you said, protons and various parts of the universe.
Well, first of all, the thing about science fiction that's really cool is that you can almost say anything if you can justify it somehow. I mean, if you look at Star Trek, for example, whoever watches Star Trek, they can travel the speed of warp speed because of dilithium crystals.
Yeah.
I don't know what a dilithium crystal is.
Yeah.
I don't know what it does. They never really explain it. It's just because we have one, we can do that.
Yeah.
You know. So you have to justify why things happen. How can the universe be 40 billion years old when redshift says it's only 3 and it, you know, it's only 4 or 14, whatever. 14 it says. And the answer is, what if the universe didn't expand at an even rate?
Mm-hmm.
What if, see, we've only been watching it for 100 years. Well, it's been around for a lot more than that. What if it expanded in fits and starts so that it took longer, so that it took more years? You know, bingo. There's an explanation that'll wash.
Yeah.
You know, what are you going to tell me? I mean, how do you explain time travel? You know, I had one of the most interesting experiences I had. We were developing a science fiction piece for Paramount, and we're sitting in the office of the executive, and we're talking about time travel, and he says, no, time travel doesn't work that way. And I said, what? Time travel is not real, you know. And he said, oh, yeah, you're right. It's like, you know, there are no rules. So, like, I made up things. I just made them up, and I checked them out to give them as much veracity as possible.
Well, reading it, Phil, I believed it.
Good. Yeah. Then I succeeded.
You
because
definitely did. And here is not a billion years in between, but before and today.
Yeah, this was when we first recorded The Lion Sleeps Tonight back in 1961, which is going to be its 50th year. We're having a worldwide Wim Away Wednesday on July 27th, 11, where we're going to stand in front of the two lions in the public library in New York and sing Wim Away, and we hope the whole world joins us.
And will you sing just a little?
No, I'll sing Wim Away.
Right now.
Yeah.
All right.
I'll sing Wim Away, but you have to sing it too.
All right.
Ready? Boom, boom, boom. How Wim Away, how Wim Away, how Wim Away, how Wim Away. See, it's Wim Away, not Wim Awack or Wiki Wack or Wiki Way. It's Wim Away. W-I-M-O-W-E-H. Wim Away.
Will you autograph my book?
I will indeed.
And we'll be back after a short pause.
Thank you.